For those of you who haven't done one of these webinars before, one of the things that Craig and I have developed is the business legal lifecycle. So this is about what we see in businesses when they should be doing things and when they can leave things to the future. Because we all know that business owners are very busy people, and doing legal things in business is something that a lot of people don't want to address. So what we've done is we've developed the business legal lifecycle as a guide to when things should be done in business from a legal point of view. There's actually a book about that, and that's available, and you can email me if you're interested about it. I wrote the book. It's about each of those phases, and it's about when you do things. I'll have some special first edition copies that I can sell at a discounted rate that you can't get anywhere else. But if you're interested about it, let me know. The purpose of this isn't to sell the book. It's just merely to let you know that exists, and you're more than welcome to join up and have a look at that business legal lifecycle if you want. And you'll see here that today's topic falls into the estate planning category or phase of the business legal lifecycle. And as I said earlier, yeah, it's a very important thing for people to get right in their estate planning and in their business, because if they don't do it at this stage of the business, then they're really going to be struggling to do it later, because it really needs to be done once you've got a viable business to bring the business forward. As I say, I discuss that more in the book, but you should feel free to ask for a copy of it if you'd like one. And if you don't already have one, well, no, there's some people on the call who already do. So the first topic I'm going to talk today is about wills. We're also going to talk about some instances of DUI and where we see problems and people getting unstuck with DUI wills and estate planning. We're going to talk about some other estate planning matters such as testamentary trusts, advanced health directives, enduring powers of attorney, binding nominations, those kind of matters. And then that's what I'm going to talk about. And then Craig's going to talk about executors and estates and the estate process. I'll give you an idea about what actually happens in that process. So to start off with, what is a will? Might seem like a straightforward question, but you'd be surprised how many people don't know the answer to that question. So a will is a legal document that says what you would like to happen to all of your assets and belongings if you pass away. The will names the people that you appoint as an executor. So the executor is the person who controls your estate. And it also names the people who are the beneficiaries, so the people who have the benefit of your estate. So that's in a nutshell what a will is. Basically, for a will to be valid, it must be in writing and it must be signed in front of two witnesses, both of whom must be over the age of 18 years old, and they can't be visually impaired, and they can't be beneficiaries of the will. One of the things that we see people get wrong quite often is that the two witnesses don't all sign at the same time. So everyone needs to be in the same room at the same time. No one can leave the room at the time, and everyone in the room has to sign. So the person making out the will has to sign the will right then and there, and the two witnesses have to sign right on the spot. And it's amazing how many times that is done wrong, and then a will can be basically invalid if that happens. And the last point on this slide is, why have a will? We get that question a lot. I'm sure you guys probably do too. Basically, having a will is the only reliable way to ensure that your estate goes to your family and friends as you choose. Different states, different territories, different countries all have different rules about where your estate goes if something happens to you when you pass away. And if you have a will, it gives you certainty as to where your estate goes. If you don't have a will, then, yeah, you don't have that certainty and your estate doesn't know where they're actually, where your estate's actually going. It also can help reduce stress for your family and friends and limits the cost of administering the estate. So Craig will go through the administration process later and you'll see that you know, in a lot of senses, if you have a will, it will cost a lot less to administer the estate than having to go through, if you die, what we call intestate, which means that you don't have a will. And it will also lessen the possibility of disputes over your estate. So the classic example of a dispute over the estate is if a client wants to exclude a relative, a son or a daughter from their will, and they've got some valid claim for it, for an interest in the will, then if you've got a properly drafted will that's been properly thought through, then that can avoid that as a possibility. I'll talk to the question now that I've received. When does a beneficiary become presently entitled? A beneficiary becomes presently entitled basically when all the conditions under the will have been met. So if the will says that the person, you know, must attain the age of 18 before that they're entitled to the estate, well, their portion of the estate, then they're presently entitled to then. Until then, it's a contingent entitlement. So I hope that answers that question. If you've got anything more, throw it into the questions. So the second topic, as I alluded to earlier, was DIY, do-it-yourself wills. So basically what we're talking about here is the problems that we see prop up when people do it themselves. As I said earlier, witnessing a will is a common mistake that people make. The amount of time that people just get those fundamental things that I discussed earlier wrong is scary and means that their will isn't valid and can be very easily challenged. The second point is inappropriate appointments. So what are we talking about here? We're talking about mainly the role of executor, and if you're going to, and I'll talk about testamentary trusts in a minute, but if you're going to have trustees of an estate or guardians for children, putting the wrong people in the wrong place is a very common mistake people make because they don't understand the different roles that are in the estate planning process. So the role of executor is probably the most important one because they're the person who is going to administer your will and make sure that everything's handed over to your beneficiaries. Appointing elderly parents or siblings or even consultants who are elderly can be a problem because what happens if something happens to them before you pass away? Then you've got to go through a process to appoint someone new. The other problem that we see with DIY is appointing minor children. So someone who's under the age of 18 can't actually administer an estate, and if they do, then if they're appointed, then that appointment's invalid. So they're common mistakes that we see with inappropriate appointments in wills. And the third category is no residuary beneficiary. So what is a residuary beneficiary? I'll start off with that just so that if anyone's not aware. A residuary beneficiary is basically the person who receives the rest of the estate after everyone else has got what you wanted them to get. So if you have a will that says that Johnny's going to get this property and Billy's going to get this property and you don't deal with all your personal belongings, that forms part of your residual estate. And if that hasn't been dealt with in the will, then it's open for challenge. It's open for debate as to what your actual intentions were. So when we see DIY wills, one of the big problems that we see is that people haven't thought about, well, what happens to everything else? They think about the big items, but they don't worry about the little things. And then sometimes the residuary has to go to a court to determine what actually what the people are actually entitled to under the will. Another thing that's a common mistake is not considering what will happen to your beneficiaries if something happens to one of them. So say you have a child and they've got children and you have, say, two children. You may want your estate to go 50-50 to each of your children, but if something happens to one of your children, you probably want that child's balance of their estate to go to, that share of their estate to go to their children. If you don't deal with that properly in the will, and this is another problem that we see often in DIY wills, then the children of your child may not actually be entitled to anything. So your grandchildren might not be entitled to anything and it may all go to the other sibling. And that can be a common mistake that we're seeing with people who don't draft their wills properly. So they're just some of the problems that we see with DIY wills. There's many others, and I'm not going to bore you with all those today. But they're the main ones that we see as being big problems. So the next topic that I want to talk about today are testamentary trusts. Testamentary trusts are a term that's often used. It's a bit of a buzzword. There's different ways to do it. But basically, what is a testamentary trust? A testamentary trust is a discretionary trust that's created in a will and takes effect on the death of the testator. So in other words, of the person who made the will. The testamentary trust has a trustee or trustees and a range of discretionary beneficiaries, just like your normal discretionary trust. So you guys as accountants would be familiar with the discretionary trust. It will name one beneficiary, then it will normally have a clause that makes all of the other people who are relatives, related companies, related trusts, all potential beneficiaries of that trust to allow for good tax planning. A testamentary trust does that in a will so that upon the person's death, the trust is established. So I've kind of answered the next question already. How does it work? It works just like any other discretionary trust. you know, the trustee has the discretion to distribute income and capital as per the will, sorry, as per the trust, and you can use that for effective tax planning. Some of the benefits of that, so why have one? There's flexibility on capital and income allocation to various beneficiaries. Each beneficiary's inheritance is protected and preserved from waste and dissipation of the assets by the beneficiary. So if you've got children that you don't trust to spend their money, you know, that's probably the most common one. Often we'll have a client who will say to us, look, we don't trust our children. They're not mature enough to receive, you know, XYZ money. So what we want is a testamentary trust where someone is appointed as a trustee. They then have control over what happens with that money on the child's behalf. The other thing too is if you've got children who, or your clients have got children who are professionals and may be subject to some sort of court order for negligence, say, or just for any reason, a testamentary trust can, now nothing's ever certain in the legal world, but a testamentary trust can protect that estate from any attack by a creditor. Probably not in family law, because family law has a concept of everything that's owned by all the parties kind of goes into one big pot. And so it's usually a financial resource, and the family court has very wide powers. And anyone who tells you otherwise is not telling you the truth. I think it's a fair thing to say. So, if you've got clients who want to protect, you know, from children's marriages, then, you know, we can set them up. It's the best protection we can give people, but it's by no means certain. And the last category is taxation reasons, as I said earlier. You know, with any discretionary trust, if you can distribute income more effectively and more tax efficiently, then you're going to be able to do a better tax position for your clients. So that's what a testamentary trust is. A testamentary trust is a more complicated will. There's no shirking that. It sets up a discretionary trust. So it is more complicated. It's for people who have, you know, good assets or they're concerned about their children. But usually, you know, yes, it costs a little bit more, but it's well worth the protection that people get out of it. So the last topic that I wanted to touch on today was further estate planning. Now, there's a bit to this, so bear with me, because there's a few different concepts that I want to explain here. And then I'm going to give you a link to our website where we actually have a resource on our website that lets you go on, and if you have a client that wants to do estate planning, then we can actually take their details off the website and you can actually, you know, give us information as we go, and so we can easily do the estate planning. We do this with a lot of our accountant and financial planner partners that we have. They provide us with the information. We're able to very easily build the wills and contact the client. So I'll provide that to you after this slide. So the first further estate planning topic that I want to talk about is enduring power of attorneys. So what's a power of attorney? A power of attorney is a formal document that gives another person the authority to make personal and or financial decisions on your behalf. So what are personal and financial decisions? Personal decisions relate to your care and welfare, including your health care. So deciding whether or not you live, consenting to medical treatment, those kind of things. Financial decisions are exactly that. So managing monetary decisions, making decisions on paying bills, selling homes, renting homes, using income to pay for needs and investing in property. So an enduring power of attorney gives those kind of powers from someone to someone else. Now, I said personal and or financial decisions because you can make the choice about whether or not you just provide someone with the power of attorney over their personal matters, so their health matters, or their financial matters. And often what happens is people will do that just to make it easier if something happens to you. So the other distinction I need to make is general power of attorneys versus enduring power of attorneys. If you lose capacity, a general power of attorney ceases to exist, or ceases to apply. So a general power of attorney only goes whilst the person has capacity. If you want people to be able to make decisions on your behalf after you lose capacity, then you need an enduring power of attorney in place. So that's a common mistake that people make, is not having the difference there. A general power of attorney generally, you know, deals with you know, financial decisions as well. They're not personal on healthcare matters. A common question that we get is, you know, if the person dies, can I still use my power of attorney? And the short answer to that is no. A power of attorney only lasts for as long as someone is alive. So then the will takes over. So quite often when we have a client who comes to see us to do their estate planning, we'll look at their not only their will, but we'll look at doing an enduring power of attorney. So if something happens to them and they lose capacity, say they have an accident, God forbid, or something like that, and they're not able to make decisions, and someone else has the ability to make those decisions. You can also have it conditional upon certain events happening. So, yeah, you have it conditional upon losing capacity or you've been overseas. So there's certain conditions that you can put in there. The only caveat that I'll put on that is that if you do have a conditional power of attorney, then people can... proving that condition has been satisfied, so you've lost capacity or that you're overseas, can be problematic. So we often recommend that people don't make it conditional, that it's unconditional, but you don't provide someone with the power of attorney that you don't trust. if you don't trust the person, then don't put them on there. So the next question, who can be your attorney? So as I say, it's got to be someone that you absolutely trust. The law states that your attorney must be over the age of 18, have mental capacity, not be a bankrupt for financial decisions, and not be your healthcare provider, such as your nurse or doctor, or a paid carer. There are some exceptions to that, but the law is pretty clear that you can't have those ones. So enduring power of attorneys have become particularly important where the client is a member of a self-managed super fund. The enduring power of attorney may allow a fund to continue to qualify as an SMSF, notwithstanding that the member may not be acting as trustee of the fund due to their incapacity. So these things, you know, as the law evolves, these things change more and more, and that's an important thing to think about. If you've got clients, and probably many of you do, that have self-managed super funds, then an enduring power of attorney helps to protect them if they do lose capacity in that and still qualify as a fund. I've got a couple of questions here. They relate more to wills, so I'll come back to them at the end of the slide, and Craig might have some input on them as well. So the next topic to talk about on this slide is advanced health directives. So I don't know whether any of you have seen an advanced health directive before, but it's basically what we call, or can be called, a living will. It's a way to give formal instructions about your future healthcare, and it only comes into effect if your cognitive health deteriorates and you become unable to make your own decisions. So an advanced health directive has 30 or 40 pages of different conditions that you might suffer, and it asks you what medical treatment that you want in the event that you suffer that condition. Understandably, it's something that we can draft, but to complete it, you need to sit down with a medical professional, a doctor, and they basically explain each of the different conditions to you, and each of those conditions is something that then needs to be, you need to decide whether or not you want to be continued cared for, you know, or not. And people usually sit down and do that with the doctor. The doctor then signs a certificate to say that they understand, or you understood what you were signing, and then it can be held with us. So it's a pretty complicated document. It's something that we would recommend people get if they're concerned about certain medical treatments, you know, if they want to make it absolutely certain as to what is to happen to them, whether or not some people might be concerned of leaving loved ones with the decision to prolong their life if something's happened to them. This gives direction and is a binding document as to what can happen. Of course, as with anything, it can be challenged, but it's usually held as a person's direction of what they actually want. So I think it's a pretty important document to have in place. And the last one topic that I want to talk about here are binding nominations. So as I said earlier, we know from our work with a lot of accountants and a lot of people on this call that you'll have self-managed super fund clients or your super fund generally. And a binding nomination is basically a document that says what's going to happen with the super fund property when the person passes away. Now, it's pretty important to have in place, and there are different trust deeds have different requirements of lapsing and non-lapsing binding nominations. And basically what happens is it's there to protect the super fund so that you know what actually happens. They're very much a case-by-case basis document, So it's something we're happy to discuss with yourselves or your clients if you've got any specific issues with them. And depending on your trustee, the self-managed super fund trustee depends on what they actually say. So binding nominations, and they're very important to have in place. So that, and they all form part of the estate planning package. So you can see that it's not just a simple matter of sitting down and doing wills for people. It's you've got wills, you've got enduring power of attorneys, you've got binding nominations, you've got advanced health records. There's a lot to it. And so there's a whole package, and something that we do a lot of with our clients is sitting down with them to give them a complete package of estate planning to make sure that they get everything that they want. So the questionnaire that I referenced before, if you just give me a second, I'll put the a link to our website into the chat box. That's our wills and estates page. That page, if you click on it, and you don't need to do it now, you can click on it later. It has an inquiry box, as all our web pages do, but it also has some forms where you can fill out information. And yeah, sometimes we get the question, oh, that's a lot of information. I don't really have the time to fill that information. That's really the that's the information that we need to be able to provide complete estate planning advice to people and their clients to do it properly. If we don't do it properly, then we're not doing the job properly. So you know, you have a flick through there. More than happy to once again answer questions as you know if you've got any as we go. But that's a good resource that we find is very helpful for a lot of the accountants and financial planners that we do business with to help them with their estate planning needs. So Craig, I think the first question is probably more along your.
Yeah, hi everyone. The question is, does a beneficiary become presently entitled as from the date of the grant of probate or some other event or date occurs? Look, it isn't necessarily the date of the grant of probate because there are some other things that may need to be done before a distribution can be made. So I guess the short answer to that is, and this is a typical lawyer's answer, is it really does depend on the particular case. And the same goes for the other question about is not presently entitled until all the conditions of the will have been met. Yes, so all the conditions of the will need to be met, but does that mean that prolonging the transfer of the assets can be a tax advantage for the beneficiaries? Look, that can be the case, but you've also got to be wary as an executor that you've got to administer the estate within a reasonable period of time. If there's no, and if any beneficiaries call on any of the income, then that needs to be done. So by prolonging it, it might be a tax advantage to the beneficiaries, but it puts the executor in a position where they may not be complying with their obligations. But I can, again, that's a case-by-case thing, and I could talk to the person asking the question, we'll take your details, and if I can, I might give you a call and we can go through it in a bit more detail.
And we've just got one final question. Usually spouses give their power of attorney to their spouse. Yep, that's right. Does this raise a problem in the SMSF self-managed super fund, if, say, the wife is acting as the attorney for her husband, so, in effect, there is only one trustee for the fund? I'll let Craig answer that because he's our expert on this.
It'd be that the wife would be acting in her own capacity, but she would also be acting as attorney. And so she would be acting in two roles, essentially, one for the benefit of the husband and one for herself in her own capacity. So, no, it wouldn't create an issue. And with self-managed super funds, it becomes more important to have that enduring power of attorney for the very reason that the question's been asked, that if something does happen to one of the trustees or directors of the company or whoever it might be, and there isn't a power of attorney in place, they've lost capacity and therefore would have to leave the fund because they wouldn't be able to be a member anymore. So it's an important thing to always have a enduring power of attorney when you've got a self-managed super fund. So, all right, well, we'll move right along. If you've got any other questions, as Jeremy said, ask them as we go. But in terms of what I was going to speak about, so this is someone's passed away and now the estate needs to be administered. So as Jeremy said, there's obviously an executor that needs to be appointed, and they're the person that is responsible for administering the estate. And it's obviously as per the wishes by the person who passed away, in accordance with their will, and obviously they also need to be aware of the Succession Act and make sure they comply with that. So essentially their responsibilities in the initial task will include obviously organising the funeral in most instances and locating the original will. So in order to take steps in an estate, an executor would need to have the original will. There are ways around it if only a copy can be found, but it does complicate things, and you need the original in order to do that. And that's why it comes back to important that if you do make a will, you need to know where the original is, need to keep records of that, tell your beneficiaries, tell your executor that the will is held at such and such. Because unfortunately, there's no state-based or national-based will register where people can put their details in to say that my will is held at Johnson & Co. It's important if you're making a will to make sure that you tell people where it is. After you find the will, obviously you need to read the will, make sure you're happy with it all. And then your duties as the executor may include obtaining a grant of probate, obviously finding and notifying the beneficiaries that will be receiving something from the estate. Need to check and protect the assets. So that could include insurance for any real property, make sure that's up to date and can continue. If the property's not been resided in, so it was the principal place, then obviously you need to check with the insurance company and make sure that the insurance is going to cover those sorts of things. And normally it does. The premiums might be a little bit higher, but as long as it's secured and those sorts of things, then that should be fine. You need to obviously collect all the valuables, make sure they're secure, any income that's coming in, so there could be rental payments, set up an account so they can go into there. You need to obviously determine the debts and the liabilities of the estate. And further to that, one thing that you guys will be more than aware of is obviously preparing tax returns and getting income tax clearances and those sorts of things to make sure that there's no tax that needs to be paid. There's going to be the transferring or sales of assets, preparing financial statements, and ultimately your end responsibility is distributing the estate. In terms of liabilities, an executor may be liable for waste where they've in their capacity used or wasted the estate or converted it to their own use, obviously. If they do something like that, then they could be liable for that. As I said before, there's a reasonable period of time when they need to administer the estate, so they need to comply with those things as well. So they can be personally liable in most instances if they're doing the right thing, and obviously they're not going to be. One thing that we come across a lot is, and you may see it as well, that your clients might, or your the loved ones of a client that's passed away may contact you about a will and say, oh, are you able to certify a copy or help me out with this estate matter? Handling of the actual will, it mightn't seem that important, but it is and can cause problems down the track. So say you receive a will and it's bound together, usually through a staple and then some form of ribbon or tape across it. Taking those things out of the will will cause issues if you were to photocopy it, for instance. So if you are going to photocopy a will to give a certified copy, then don't take it apart. Don't ever place, say, a paperclip or anything like that on an original will, because if the person passes away and the original will is then before the court for a probate application or something along those lines, and there are staple holes or an imprint of a rusty paperclip or something like that on the will, then further evidence will need to be provided at that time, because the court will ask about the problems with the will, and you'll need to go back and swear an affidavit as to what you might have done with the will, you photocopied it, etc., etc. The reason behind that is obviously the court needs to be certain that someone hasn't inserted a page or taken a page out, all those sorts of things that someone unscrupulous may do, to gain a benefit, so that they take extra care and look at these sorts of things. You mightn't think a staple hole is going to be picked up, but it does. Then it prolongs the process, unfortunately, and the costs will go up. With intestacy, so Jeremy touched on that. So that's if you don't have a will, or for some reason a gift fails. So that's governed by the Succession Act and the distribution of that. So if you pass away and you don't have a will, then and you have a spouse and no issue or children, then your entire estate will go to your spouse. If you have a spouse and you have a child, and the estate is worth less than $150,000, excluding the household chattels, then all of that will go to the spouse. If the value exceeds $150,000, excluding the household chattels, then all of the household chattels will go to your spouse. $150,000 will go to your spouse as well, and half of the rest of the estate to your spouse. And if you only have one child, then they'll get the other half, or depending on how many children are, it could be a third, etc., etc. So it's important to have a will in that sense, because if you do pass away in intestacy and those sorts of things happen, that may not be how you want it to be. There's also issues, obviously, if you've got de facto spouses, or if you're separated but not divorced. So separation doesn't revoke a will, which would mean that your spouse could still be receiving something in intestacy, regardless of whether or not you're separated. If you're divorced, then that's different. But if you're separated, then they'd still be counted as a spouse and could be receiving, household chattels, $150,000, and half of the rest of the estate. So very important to consider those things. And the same goes with, gifts that might fail, or the residual beneficiary, if there isn't one appointed, then potentially that can go into intestacy as well, because there isn't a beneficiary appointed for those gifts under the estate. So something that definitely needs to be considered. So I touched on the court's involvement. So most of you would probably have come across the term probate before. So that's where we're talking about, just in Queensland, obviously, at this point, but most of the other states in Queensland have a similar system. So probate is essentially the Supreme Court of Queensland official recognition that the will is legally valid. And it recognises that the executor has the authority to deal with the estate, and that they can take control of the estate's assets, i.e. administer the estate. There's no actual statutory requirement to obtain a grant of probate. Most banks and financial institutions will not insist on one if the cash at the bank is less than $50,000. That'll be across all of their bank accounts as well. So if you had an instance where you had $20,000 in one and $25,000 in another and then $30,000 in another, and they're all with the CBA, for instance, that'll be above their threshold of $50,000, and they will require probate because it's across three accounts. Most nursing homes will require a grant of probate these days for releasing the nursing home bond back to the estate. Transferring of land really depends, one, on the tenancy. So if it's a joint tenants, you don't need a grant of probate in order to have that transferred to the remaining tenant. That is just through a record of death that's filed with the titles office, as well as a death certificate, and that will then remove the deceased person from a jointly held real property asset and go to the remaining person. In terms of transfer of land not in joint tenants, then it really depends on the value of the land as to whether or not you will require probate. But in most instances, if there is property and there's cash in the bank, most estates are going to require a grant of probate. And it does also give the executor an extra level of protection if it is someone sort of outside the family, for instance. Getting a grant of probate is probably recommended, and then they can do you know, all the things they need to do. If someone passes away without a will, then instead of obtaining a grant of probate, the court will make a similar an order. Instead of a grant of probate, it's called a letters of administration. They're essentially exactly the same. Basically, the letters show that the court has examined the relevant documents, so that's that the person that's applying is, you know, the spouse or the children or someone that's got a right to apply to be the administrator. And they'll examine all those documents and they'll provide what's called letters of administration, which is essentially the same as probate and is recognised by banks or nursing homes or Department of Titles for the same purpose as probate, which will allow you to transfer property or, you know, access bank accounts or get the nursing home bond back. So it's, you know, as I said, 9 times out of 10, most estates will require a probate application. It's a process that involves advertising in the local paper, so it could be the Courier Mail, but it might necessarily be. There's a publication through the court practice direction about other publications, so it could be the Gold Coast Bulletin, the South Bend Times. You know, there's other smaller papers that it can be advertised in, and basically you're advertising to say that a particular person's passed away and that you're going to make an application for probate or letters of administration. You advertise, they need to wait a period of 14 days, and after that period of time, you then file the relevant documents with the court. So there's an application, affidavits to say that you've done the advertising, that you've told the public trustee, that you've got the death certificate, that you've got the original will, that you're the executor, you know, one and the same as the executor, those sorts of things. All of that gets put into affidavits, and it's then filed with the court. The court then processes that, and they look at it. They look at the death certificate to see how someone might have passed away, and if it says on there that there was an illness of dementia or any other capacity type questions, they will ask. And so it's better to obviously study that before you do that to make sure that it's, you know, going to comply. And if there are questions about capacity, then you need to address that in the affidavit. You may need to get further evidence from, for instance, a solicitor that made the will, or from a doctor to say that, you know, Neville in 2006 had capacity and there was no issues. All those sorts of things need to be put before the court. And then they should grant probate. They normally take about 6 to 8 weeks. Just got a question here. Are wills made in another state still valid? What are the problems arising from these types of estates? So, situations. look, they are still valid if they're made in a different state. What happens with probate is that you've got to file for probate in the state where assets are held. So if you've got property in Queensland, for instance, then you apply for probate here. If you've got assets in Queensland and Victoria, then you can apply in either one. And what happens is it's called a reseal of a probate. So you do it in New South Wales, you get probate, and you administer whatever assets that are there. You then need to make the application to the Queensland court, for instance, to have a reseal of the probate document. And essentially it's filing that and they give you back a piece of paper that's from the Supreme Court of Queensland, and then you can administer any assets that are held in different states. So I think that answers your question. What are the problems arising from these types of situations? Yeah, so the problems are that, you know, there's some extra steps that may need to be done in terms of where assets are held. But if it's just a straight up will and all, say you move to Queensland, for instance, and you have one in New South Wales and you don't hold any assets in New South Wales anymore, then there shouldn't be any problems. There are other issues that do come up occasionally with where bank accounts might be held, and like BSBs might be linked to a bank account in New South Wales. And really, most banks will not make you do a reseal of the probate for, you know, for New South Wales, for instance, but it can cause an issue. So, yeah, I mean, you should, if you have moved and you do have a will that's, you know, from a different country, for instance, or another state, it's probably not a bad idea to update that to be where you're living and where you're, you know, mainly you're going to be holding your assets. So, yeah, situations can arise or problems can arise. So it's probably best to update it. With the court as well, so they can be involved in what's called a rectification application. So if there was a clerical error, for instance, or there's information that says that the will doesn't give rise to what the testator wanted it to do for whatever reason, then there can be an application made to the court to rectify the will. Again, the costs of that are quite high because you've obviously go off to court, make the application. So it goes back to important to make sure you read your will before you sign it and those sorts of things to make sure you're happy with it. That doesn't happen that much anymore, but it is something that's available if there's a clerical error that makes the will invalid for whatever reason, or a gift can't be given, or we know that it doesn't affect the testator's instructions. Just quickly as well, it's probably a topic that we could do a whole webinar on, but family division applications, which you would have heard of, that's essentially where someone might be unhappy with the will and what they're receiving. Normally it's a child or someone that's dependent on that person, or the spouse, for instance. They can make an application to the court basically to say, well, they should be receiving a larger share or whatever it might be. Children or child is defined as any child, obviously, but it also includes stepchildren or adopted children. And dependent is obviously someone that's wholly or substantially supported by the deceased. So they can make an application to the court. They've got to give notice to the executor within 6 months of the date of death. Then they need to bring the actual application to the court within 9 months. It's then through the court system and there's a determination as to what's going to happen. As I said, I could talk about that all day, so I'll move on. If you've got any questions about family division applications, please ask and we can come back to you at a later date. I'm just conscious of the time. Going over. So just in terms of the administration process, we've spoken about probate where you need to get that. Most of the time that's the first couple of things that you'll do. The funeral expenses, most of the time that'll be paid from the bank. The bank will give that money out in order to pay for that, so you won't need probate to pay for the funeral. Obviously you need to consult tax experts about any tax that may be needed to be paid or final tax returns that need to be completed. That's one thing that a lot of people will miss, and that's where you guys come into play in terms of giving the advice about the tax advice, which obviously you don't want to distribute an estate and then find out that there's a whole lot of tax that needs to be paid. So an important step in any administration. Then there's obviously the transfer of property. I spoke about joint tenancy. It can be transferred under different ways through a transmission application through the court. Another thing that may come up in your capacity with some of your clients is commission for an estate. So if you're appointed as an executor on behalf of one of your clients, which I have seen happen on a number of occasions, there are provisions in the Succession Act that allow someone to apply for commission. 5% of the estate is basically the cap, and it won't go any higher than that. The court takes into account various things, whether or not the person's getting a benefit from the estate as well, so double dipping. It's a discretionary step that the court may take, and they take into account various things. It can be that all the beneficiaries can agree to that, and there's a deed signed to say that, okay, we'll give the executor a commission of 2%, and that commission will be taxable. Obviously, there's distribution of specific gifts that need to be done. So if it says, my cricket bat signed by Don Bradman, those sorts of things, then they need to be given to that particular person. If it's something that produces income, then that income goes with that specific gift as well. So if it was a property, for instance, then that income also goes with it. Then there's general legacies and those sorts of things. So if there's insufficient to pay all the legacies in full under a general legacy, then they'll be abated, prorated in proportion. So, if they were getting 100,000, but it would be 70 or whatever it might be. Then obviously there's the residuary gifts, which most of the time, hopefully if it's been drafted properly, there's a residual beneficiary. A lot of times that can actually be the lion's share of an estate. Specific gifts, you aren't necessarily the best way of dealing with things, because you might sell that or lose a particular item or whatever it might be, and then those gifts will fail. Or you might sell a property and then buy another one, but you're giving the old property to someone, and that gift will fail as well. And that'll form part of the residual estate, which potentially could be, as I said, the lion's share of your estate. So you need to make sure that you're always appointing a residual beneficiary. So, I mean, they're mainly the... And then, obviously, you finalise the estate and hand out the money or whatever it might be. You need to make sure you found all the beneficiaries and that they, sign off on receiving checks or receiving money or those sorts of things. Once you've done all that, then you've complied with your tax obligations, obviously, which is where you're speaking to an accountant. And then you finalise your estate. And during the process, obviously, you need to keep proper books and records and accounts of whatever you've been doing. The court can audit those as well if someone has a problem. So it's important to keep, proper books and records, which, when you're talking to your clients, obviously you'd be involved in that process more likely than not. But if you're appointed as an executor in an estate, you'd know better than anyone to keep proper books and records in case you're ever audited, because you don't want the court, questioning certain things if you haven't done something incorrectly. So always keep proper books and records. We've got a question here. When do the state trustees step in and take over an estate? They would step in if there isn't anyone that's eligible to apply for letters of administration, for instance. They would also step in if there isn't any beneficiaries under an intestacy left. So once it goes through spouses, children, brothers and sisters, parents, the family, then eventually it will go with the Crown, and the state trustee will probably step in and administer that process. So unless, of course, you're appointing the public trustee as your executor, then obviously they'll come in straight away, which you can do, and a lot of people do that. The public trustee in Queensland used to charge a percentage of the estate, so they do your will for free and then charge a percentage. My understanding is that's now changed, and they charge an hourly fee to administer an estate, but they still do free wills, from my understanding. So, yeah, that's when the state trustee would step in. And obviously we're based in Queensland. My understanding is most of the other public trustees in other states will be the same. There's no other questions, and I've got nothing else to say, so I'll throw it back over to Jeremy for a second.
Yeah, okay, so thanks, Craig. I hope everyone found that informative. Got a couple more minutes just to go through some final things. So if you've got any other questions, please throw them into the questions box. And if you do have anything else, once again, there's a nice picture of Craig and I on that slide with our email addresses. Please feel free to email us. We're always happy to answer questions and help out, because we want to make sure that things are done right. There was a few latecomers to the webinar. I'm just going to post again into the chat box, a link to our Dropbox folder. That folder contains a copy of the slides that we went through today. And it will also contain a copy of the recording of this webinar that we will save in there once we've edited and all the rest of it. That should be later today or tomorrow. And we'll send around an email that has a link to that as well. I'd also like to ask, when you close down the application, go to webinar, it should come up and ask you to complete a questionnaire. We're always very interested in feedback. We love to know, make sure we're hitting the mark with these webinars, because there's no point in us doing them if they're not useful for you. If you think that we could do better somewhere, or there's other, and especially if there's other topics that you want us to hear to talk about from a legal point of view, then please complete the questionnaire, or even feel free to email us if you've got a specific topic that you'd like us to cover. As I say, the purpose of these aren't to talk about any specific topic. It's to talk about topics that are of interest to you guys, and that you guys will find helpful. So, as I say, if you could please fill out the questionnaire, and please be honest and be truthful with any other topics that you like, because the more that we can tailor this to what you guys as accountants need, the better that we can do them and answer your questions. So it doesn't look like, Greg, that we've got any other questions from anyone. So I'd like to once again thank everyone for joining us today. As I say, we'll send around an email with a link to the Dropbox folder if you'd like to revisit any of today's topics or answers to any questions or anything that we covered today. And thank you very much for attending.
Thank you, everyone.